Welcome back, geology students. This is video two, or chapter nine, on geologic time. We previously introduced the term unconformity and conformable rock layers. What I want to look at today are the three types of unconformities. Remember, unconformities are gaps in geologic time. Unconformities can form in two ways. Either there was a period of time without any deposition of sediment, or rocks were eroded. The first unconformity is the easiest for students to identify. It is an unangular unconformity. This is a situation where you have sedimentary rocks that are tilted. Then the erosional surface, the unconformity, followed by horizontal layers of sedimentary rocks. So the entire sequence consists of sedimentary rocks. The second type of unconformity is a disconformity. In this situation, we still have all sedimentary rocks. However, the sedimentary rocks are flat-lying below the unconformity and flat-lying above the unconformity. These disconformities can be a little difficult to distinguish in the field if there isn't a nice erosional surface. The third type of unconformity is a non-conformity. In this situation, you have igneous or metamorphic rocks in contact with sedimentary rocks. All three of these unconformities can be seen in the Grand Canyon. In this first figure, this image is showing what we call a disconformity. We have horizontal layers of sedimentary rock, the unconformity, just an erosional surface, followed by additional flat-lying horizontal rocks. A non-conformity is an unconformity that has either igneous and or metamorphic rocks in contact with sedimentary rocks. These are your sedimentary rocks here. This is a view of the Grand Canyon. Here we have the inner gorge cut out by the Colorado River. If we look at the bottom picture here, the bottom of the sequence of strata, we have the Vishnu schist and the Zoroaster granite. Let me ask you this. Which is older, the schist or the granite? Based on that principle of cross-cutting relations, the Vishnu schist has to be older because the granite is intruding it. Therefore, if granite intrudes something, it is younger than whatever it is intruding. Back to the unconformities now. Along here, we have a non-conformity because we have metamorphic rocks in contact with flat-lying sedimentary rocks. Here is another nonconformity. From this point all the way over, we have an angular unconformity. That is a situation where you have tilted, in this case, sedimentary rocks in contact with flat-lying sedimentary rocks. Finally, these two examples up in the red wall, limestone and supai group, represent disconformities. Would you be able to recognize this unconformity as an angular unconformity? Or this unconformity as a disconformity? You should be able to. See if you can go through these images, starting with working out the geologic history, and order any the events from oldest to youngest. This is what I call a relative age dating problem. When we start here, we have layer A deposited first, then B, C, and E. This is according to the law of superposition. Sediment generally gets deposited when water is covering an area, such as this ocean here. Going to the second picture, we have the ocean gone, exposing rock layer E to erosion. Erosion of the land occurs when it's not covered by water in general. Added to this relative age dating, we had said that A was deposited first, then B, C, E. Now we have a sill that has intruded between C and E, so it would have occurred after E had been deposited. Here we've added another igneous intrusion, so F would occur after the sill because it is crossing the sill. We can see that the layers are no longer flat-lying, so we refer to that as being tilted. I'm sorry about that. Rock layers were eroded as well. And then we have layers G, H, I, J, and K being deposited once again when the ocean returns. That's when sediment gets deposited. The land is eroded when there's no water covering it. This is how these unconformities form. Oceans come in to the continents, deposit sediment that turns into sedimentary rock. Oceans regress, the land erodes. Fossils are the traces or remains of prehistoric life that happen to get preserved in our rock record. There is a bias of fossils represented by marine organisms. That is because in the ocean, the constant raining down of sediment varies organisms very quickly. That is important in getting preserved and becoming a fossil. Paleontology is the actual study of fossils. And understanding fossils and identifying them helps us correlate rock layers across an area. Looking at different types of fossilization, the first example is permineralization. This occurs when mineral-rich groundwater flows through porous tissue or shells or wood that has been buried under the sediment. This water that travels through the sediment will then precipitate out minerals in the pore spaces. So petrifaction or petrified is another term that we can use for permineralization. The next type of fossilization I like to call replacement. Your book uses the term molds and casts, and that's a particular type of replacement. A mold is created when a shell, for example, gets buried. Groundwater flows through, dissolves the shell away. There you have the mold. That mold now has water continue to flow through it, and as a result, mineral matter will precipitate out in that void, and we call that then the cast. Other types of fossilization include carbonization and impressions. Carbonization occurs when an organism gets buried and compressed. That process squeezes out gases and liquids, and you get a thin layer of carbon left behind. If the carbon is removed, we call the fossilization an impression. Amber is tree sap, very sticky, gooey material. When an organism, such as an insect, encounters amber or tree sap, it gets stuck in it and hardens, and therefore the organism is preserved in amber. A trace fossil is indirect evidence that an organism was there. These include tracks, burrows, coprolites, which is fossilized poo, and gastroliths. See if you can identify each of these types of fossilization before looking at the actual name. Hopefully you recognize petrified wood, which is permineralization, which is hardening of the fossil, a mold and cast, a type of replacement fossilization. This is carbonization, an impression where the carbon has been removed, an insect in amber, and then a trace fossil, in this case, coprolite. I'm going to stop this lecture here, and we'll continue on with what makes a good fossil? How do you know if something is going to be preserved? What are the criteria that need to be met?